It's summertime, 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 summertime.
Hello, and welcome to episode 18, the summer startup edition of Notes from the Aisle Seat, the podcast that covers the arts in Northern Chautauqua County, sponsored by the 1891 Fredonia Opera House. My name is Tom Laughlin, and I'm your host as we bring you news and information about arts events at the Opera House and around the region, including interviews with artists and creators across the county. Even though the calendar says that summer is still a little less than a month away, the Memorial Day weekend has always signaled the unofficial start of the summer season. The days are hitting their peak hours of sunlight, with sunrises well before 6 a.m. and sunsets close to 9 p.m. With the threat of frost almost completely gone, gardens are being planted. The springtime blooms are just about gone, and everything is now covered in a fresh coat of green. It's that really nice time of the year, where we no longer complain about the cold of winter, but we're just short of complaining about the summer heat and humidity. So enjoy it while you can. It's also that time of year when life begins to slow down. The college has held its graduation ceremonies, students have mostly left for the summer, high school students will begin preparing for their finals, and life in general just moves to a slower rhythm. That's true here at the Opera House as well, where the list of events begins to grow just a bit smaller. For this episode, I've downsized a bit, as we'll be covering just two major events in the region, the North Shore Arts Alliance's Art Trail Hub Crawl, and the return of the Bach and Beyond Festival, a celebration of the work of Johann Sebastian Bach and his contemporaries. So let's begin our summer startup episode talking about taking a leisurely summer road trip throughout the world of art. The North Shore Arts Alliance's Art Trail has been as much of an indicator of the start of the summer season as the blooms on the region's grapevines. When those ubiquitous red signs begin to pop up on lawns across the region, you know the first fruits of summer are close at hand. This year, the North Shore Arts Alliance will once again be sponsoring the Art Trail Hub Crawl on Saturday and Sunday, May 28th and 29th, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. each day. I had another wonderful chat with the president of this all-volunteer organization, Ms. Marcia Merrins. She's put in hours of work getting this hub crawl ready, and she's pretty excited about it.
It's a pleasure to welcome back to the podcast Marcia Merrins. Marcia is on the board of directors for the North Shore Arts Alliance, and she is here to talk about the upcoming Art Trail Hub Crawl, which happens every Memorial Day weekend and Labor Day weekend. So we're coming up on Memorial Day, Marcia.
Oh, we sure are. Thanks for having me, Tom. It's a beautiful, I think it's almost a summery day here, and hopefully we'll have nice weather next weekend. I think we're scheduled for nice weather according to my app. But we certainly welcome people from all around the area and beyond to join us for the Chautauqua Lake Erie Art Trail Hub Crawl. That's quite a mouthful of words, but it gives participants an idea of what it's all about. Although somebody recently misread it and called it a pub crawl, which it is not. It helps to brand Chautauqua. We're trying to help brand Chautauqua County as a destination. And we're trying to, maybe the word is institutionalize, Memorial Weekend as a day on a calendar of people where they know they can come to this area and really have a very pleasant day or weekend. The Art Crawl, the Art Trail Hub Crawl is over Memorial Weekend from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. It is the signature event of the organization that I'm proud to be president of, which is North Shore Arts Alliance. And that organization was founded in 2007 as a not-for-profit cooperative marketing organization to promote basically artists and promote Chautauqua County. So we believe, and I think lots of people do, believe that art actually strengthens an image of a county or a village or a town. And the quality of life is also enriched by things like an art trail.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. I think that the art trail hub crawl has been around for some time, and it gets more and more exposure every year. And I think trying to make Chautauqua County a destination, particularly in the summertime when it's so beautiful here for tourists, you know, this sort of it's a great kickoff event, I think, on Memorial Day weekend.
Yeah, we actually bookend the summer with Memorial weekend and Labor Day weekend, and try to catch visitors to the area at both ends. Many of the stops along the way are available to local people all the time with a phone call. But you're right, we do try to get a lot of publicity about the organization out to many different areas. We've had listings in local newspapers, both north and south, for the last four weekends, trying to highlight each of the 24 artists that are on the art trail. We have 14 hubs, and I'll explain what that is in a moment.
I was just going to ask you that.
Yeah. So, one of the things that it used to be just a studio tour. And so there were a lot of artists who could not participate because they had studios that were in a bedroom, in a basement, in a laundry room. And so it wasn't accessible to the public. So we opened it up to enable artists to gather at different locations, and we call those hubs. So I, for example, will have my studio here, and I will have two other artists in the driveway with me. And so Nitty Gritty Works is a hub. The other hubs are galleries, because there are a lot of artists who own galleries to sell their own work, but also to earn a living by getting commissions from selling other artists' work. So we had galleries, and we had individual studios, and now we have hubs. So we have a whole mess of ways that visitors on the art trail can experience a studio where mine, you can see my work in various stages of progress. And you could go to a hub where there are artists who will be delighted to talk about their work and what inspires them. And you can learn a lot by going on the trail, but also have the opportunity to buy, which again lifts the whole boat. It's good for artists, it's good for community, especially if you go find something happening at the Opera House or have lunch downtown in Westfield or Jamestown while you're on the art trail, stop at a winery. So it's really wonderful to have these hubs, and enables every artist that has enough product to be a part of the art trail.
Yeah, and actually, Marcia, I won't say stunned, because I do know a little bit about the art scene in Chautauqua County, but I am very proud, actually, to say that there's like 14 hubs to travel over this weekend, 14 of them. Now, how many artists on average are at each hub?
Oh, well, like a gallery, like Portage Hill Gallery is a gallery, and they have two artists there that will be highlighted outside in show tents, you know, in the canopy tents, as I will. So there, you get to experience the gallery. Not of all the work in there will be artists that are on the tour, but you get to look at and buy Audrey Dowling's work, Tim Sievertson's work, and Karen Glosser's work, and they're on the art trail. One of the things we're doing this year is we have passports, which is something new to encourage visitors to try to hit all 14 hubs. So if you go to each hub, and you have, it looks like this, it looks like, I know this is, you get a stamp for each right. hub. If you fill out all the stamps over both weekends, or if you can do it one weekend, that's great. You leave it at the last stop, and that entitles you to participate in a drawing for a $100 gift certificate for art for any of the artists that are on the art trail. And we'll be giving out three of those. And I think that encourages people to go to some of the outlying areas, like Matt McNaughton is in Forestville.
Right.
And he's a wonderful clay sculptor. He has whimsical, wonderful things that you can see. And he's new to the art trail. And if you get a stamp from him, that'll be wonderful. And maybe you will get to win one of his works. So it's really kind of great for that.
I love I love his name, Farm Boy Enterprises.
Yeah. He's kind of fun. The other thing is all of our printed media has a QR code. So we are definitely well into the 21st century in North Shore Arts Alliance. So
yeah, definitely.
If you point your camera at that, that will take you to an interactive map. So you can click on it and a location, kind of plan the trail for yourselves around the county. And at the same time, you can highlight the artist. So you can highlight a hub. And then if you go in listing of the artists in the hub, you can actually go to their website. So if you want to see, well, what is Nitty Gritty Works all about? It'll click you to my website or Susan Forrester McKay's website, who will also be with me. So we have that interactive map, we have the passport, we have the QR code, we have rack cards all around the country, all around the county, hopefully, it's not the country. And we also have these wonderful maps.
Oh my, look at that.
Place. So this is what it looks like on the website. And it's also, we have those that restaurants can use as place mats. So we call them place maps. And so we're trying to hit every way we can. We have a lot, we have two people working on social media, on Facebook and Instagram. So I encourage everybody to go to nsaa.org website. You can go to our Instagram, North Shore Arts Alliance, and you can go to our Facebook page, North Shore Arts Alliance. And there's all kinds of wonderful short videos that one of our artists, Lisa Eppolito, did that will tell you a lot about what's going to happen and what you'll see at during the art trail. So we're trying everything, even podcasts, I have to say. So the other thing is the weekend of, and you've seen a few of them around now, are these big red signs mm-hmm. that says Art Trail, and those will have arrows during a Memorial weekend. So if you're not using your phone or you're not comfortable with your phone and you are using a map, it will put the address in and you will see the arrows kind of leading the way, kind of the yellow brick road for the art trail.
I've got to say that I'm going to call out your website, by the your website, not so much your website, but your Facebook page, because your mm-hmm. Facebook page is astounding. I was, looking at it before the interview, and perhaps the thing that I can recommend most to listeners is just a simple fact that gallery tour, you can go like slide by slide. And every time you make a different slide, you get the different location. You can see exactly where it is on a map. You can zoom in, you can zoom out. This is incredible. This is incredible technology, which will make it very, very easy for people to get around the area and map their ride. And it goes through some of the most beautiful scenery in the county as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And as I said, the weekend so far looks like it's going to be a great weekend. So I hope everybody gets their gardening done ahead of time on Memorial Day. I did want to also say that everybody that is that made this happen are volunteers. The people that have done the Facebook page, Lisa Polito and Karen Glosser, and Instagram, and each artist also posts and tries to the extent that they can, knowledge-wise, do social media. We really have tried to cover every base we can. So it's really up to the community to support this event, because it is an expression of how vital and vibrant this community is when it comes to the arts.
Yeah, and I've got to say that some of this art is stunning. I've seen stuff from stained glass work, painting, there's sculpture, there's pottery. One of your artists does wearable art. She does magnificent scarves.
Yeah.
There's just so much out there. Now tell me, Marcia, if I go into one of these hubs and I really want to buy something, how can I pay for it?
Every artist that is selling things generally will have a square and be able to take, I can take all kinds of things. I can take a check. I can take a credit card. And I can take cash, of course. That's the idea. They should be able to handle any kind of purchase that anybody would like to do. And, you know, I have to say, it's one of the riches of Chautauqua County is that there is a core of talented and varied artists that live and work here. And a lot of the artists on the trail are known nationwide. Audrey Dowling, Jim Reno Pottery, Tom Anier Photography, Tom Janik Photography. They have a reputation that is far beyond the physical boundary of Chautauqua County. Absolutely. So, I think it's a great event, and I'm proud to be a part of this organization. It's really super.
Yeah, it's. I think it grows every year. I think I can remember the first few, and you know, when there were the signs, and you had to struggle to find your way around. But the level of development and sophistication is quite impressive. I really think that, you know, again, the listeners shouldn't be awed by this. They will, if the weather is great, just driving around the county, going to these hubs and seeing the art. It's a terrific way to spend the weekend.
Absolutely, and enjoy what Chautauqua County has to offer. It's just a great place to live, and I think this, as I keep saying, enhances the community beyond words.
Beyond words, yeah. And I think I also think that, you know, it's not my job to promote businesses, but I know that there are many places to enjoy great lunches in the county, and of course we're the second largest wine producing region in the state. So you can pair it with that. There's so many things to pair the weekend with. You just can't miss.
The other thing I want to say is that this happens because of some grant money that we get. Our membership is open to not just artists. We're open to the community. And the community membership, which is only $35, support this effort. Each artist on the trail contributes $100 to be a part of the trail and help with marketing it. But it's really the community that helps us. And we also have sponsorships for $100. And you don't have to be a business. You can be somebody that just supports the art. And that will give you a place on our interactive map if you wish it, or just a listing for sure on our website. But if you're a business, we can lead people right to your business on our interactive map. So we have about 130 community members and probably about 50 are artists, and nobody on the board gets paid. We're all volunteers, and you know, we try not to do bake sales. We just try to ask for sponsorships and support of the community. So all the bookkeeping, all the office work, all of the things that you see, planning out the ads and writing the articles for the newspaper, are all done by volunteers. All the graphic design, everything is done by volunteers in this organization. So I'm really hoping that all of our efforts to inform this community about this event are worthwhile, and hope people will join me. Actually, I haven't never been on the art trail. I've only been a part of it, but join us and other people who come from Ohio, Erie, Buffalo, visitors who are just coming here for the summer. So sometimes we get visitors from Florida and the Midwest, and it's so much fun to meet people. And artists love to talk about their work. They really do. They love to tell you about it.
Yes, they do. Absolutely. All right, Marcia, it is always such a pleasure to talk to you, because you're such a positive force for art, for the arts in the county, in many, many ways that, you know, I could continue to talk about, but I only have so much time. So
I always enjoy talking to you, and enjoy the podcasts that I hear. And I certainly enjoy them. So thank you so much for having me.
You bet, Marcia. Take care now.
Bye-bye now.
It's hard to think of a better way to start the summer than grabbing a bit of breakfast, visiting a couple of galleries, having a light summer lunch, visiting a few more galleries, and then perhaps checking out a tasting at a local winery along the way before dinner. Oh, and bring your wallet. And support these artists by buying their work. It's the best way you can help and encourage local artists to continue producing artwork in the region. The North Shore Arts Alliance's Art Hub Crawl takes place on Saturday and Sunday, May 28th and 29th from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Check out our show notes at aisleseat.podbean.com for more information and web links to help you plan your personal Art Hub Crawl. Here's the arts calendar for the next 2 weeks and slightly beyond. The next Live at the Met broadcast will be presented on Saturday, June 4th at 1 p.m. This will be a production of Australian composer Brett Dean's Hamlet. Composed in 2017, this is its Metropolitan Opera House premiere. Please note that this is a rescheduling of this performance from its date of June 25th. If you have a subscription ticket for Hamlet, it will be honored on June 4th. The Live at the Met series concludes its 2021-22 season with this contemporary masterpiece, which features tenor Alan Clayton as Hamlet and soprano Brenda Ray as Ophelia. Coming to the 1891 Fredonia Opera House on Saturday, June 18th at 7:30 p.m. as part of the Folk in Fredonia series will be the folk icon Tom Paxton and the Don Juans. Tom Paxton is a legend in the world of folk music and one of the greatest singer-songwriters in the past 50 years. A Lifetime Achievement Grammy Award winner in 2009, he has played around the world and written such folk classics as The Marvelous Toy, Last Thing on My Mind, Ramblin' Boy, and Goin' to the Zoo. You won't want to miss this very special event by a folk music legend. Tom Paxton and the Don Juans will be at the Fredonia Opera House on Saturday, June 18th, so get your tickets as soon as you can. The Opera House will also be holding its basket raffle over the coming weeks in connection with the Bach and Beyond Festival. The raffle baskets have been donated by local businesses and contributors. A page of tickets costs only $10, and you can place as few or as many tickets into whatever raffle basket prize you fancy.
The raffle baskets will be available until July 5th, and the drawing will take place on July 6th. As a side note, the Bach and Beyond barbecue that usually takes place with the festival had a scheduling conflict, and so now it will be held in the fall on September 17th. There will be a second basket raffle at that time if you don't manage to win one this time around. Call the box office at 716-679-1891 if you'd like more information about the basket raffles. And finally, the Lakeshore Center for the Arts in Westfield presents the second weekend of Becky's New Car, a play by Stephen Dietz, directed by Tina Rausa, and featuring Jen Davis, Steve Wendell, and Doc Hamels, performed in the beautiful Jacqueline Phillips Theater. Show dates are Friday and Saturday, May 27th and 28th at 7:30 p.m., and Sunday, May 29th at 2 p.m. Tickets can be obtained by calling 716-224-2135 or by visiting their website at lakeshorecenterforthearts, all one word, .com, and clicking on their online ticket link. For the past 2 years, the 1891 Fredonia Opera House has sat shuttered in early June as the Bach and Beyond Festival, usually one of the most popular and certainly the most enduring event the Opera House has presented, had to be canceled due to the pandemic. 2020 was to have been the festival's 25th annual season, celebrating a quarter century of live performances of Baroque classical music. It was an empty feeling, to be sure, as one of the signature events of the early summer season simply vanished. This summer, though, the festival makes its return, although in a more trimmed-down fashion, as the virus remains a concern for performing artists everywhere. To celebrate this 25th version of the festival, Maestro Grant Cooper, the festival's originator and artistic driving force, has managed to package a very neat program highlighting not only the work of Bach, but works by those who have been influenced by Bach. I spoke with the maestro about the program and also about the history of the festival and its significance. It's a great honor for me to welcome to the podcast an old colleague, collaborator, and friend, Maestro Grant Cooper, who will be coming back for the 25th annual Bach and Beyond Baroque Music Festival at the 1891 Fredonia Opera House. Grant, welcome to the podcast. So good to have you.
Great to be here.
So I have a million questions, but I only have about 20 minutes or so. So I'm going to try
Let's do the math on that then.
Okay. Absolutely. Let's first talk about it's the 25th anniversary. So that's a quarter of a century. And I'm curious to get a little bit about two things about that significant number, how it got started in the first place. So we can get a little history for those people who maybe weren't around when it first started, and why you keep coming back.
Yeah, everybody asks me that. how did it get started? It got started because of the great thing that happened in the early 90s, I guess it was, of the Opera House being saved from being demolished, mm-hmm. being returned to some of its former glory, and in fact, over the last quarter century now, has flourished as a presenting organization. They wanted to have something that could be unique to the Opera House that was not being duplicated at the college. And at that time, I either was just ending my tenure at Fredonia or was still in it. I think I might have moved on to Ithaca College at that point. But they asked Jay East and myself to come in and talk to them about an event that might fit the bill. And the reason for that was that then it was called the Fredonia Chamber Players that Jay East had started and invited me to conduct. We were putting on professional level music concerts on a regular basis on campus at Fredonia. And the new administration at the Opera House wondered if there was something that we could do that wouldn't duplicate that. They didn't want to be in competition. But maybe we had some ideas. And I was really glad to get that prompt because I did have some ideas. And particularly the idea of doing a Baroque-focused music festival appealed to me. Back then, and this is mid-90s, I think, back then there was a certain amount of glibness that classically trained musicians brought to their performance of Baroque music, because on the surface, it's relatively not that difficult. It doesn't look hard. It's filled with the usual scales and arpeggios that we expect, and so nothing really surprises us about Baroque music. And as a result, I think, unfortunately, there was a tendency to underestimate the music, especially its potential possibilities, because so much wasn't written down. So much was implied just in the natural speech patterns of the musical language that players of that time, of Bach's time, just knew. And when they spoke music, they spoke Baroque music. That was the music they were speaking at the time. So we got this idea of doing a Baroque music festival, and came up pretty quickly, I think, with the clever title Bach and Beyond, because that then allowed us to say, well, we can go beyond Bach by going out from Bach. We can go beyond Bach by going back before Bach. And we can go beyond Bach as to what happened in the 20th century. At that time, it was still the 20th century. Now in the 21st century, what does Bach's music mean today to composers? Which actually is going to be a pretty big focus of this year's festival, 2022. And yeah, so every year we kept putting at it. The big changes at the beginning were the Opera House back in 1996 was not air conditioned. Well, we found that to be a problem. Mm-hmm. Particularly to keep a harpsichord in some sort of tuning. And I think the festival was one of the reasons why the leadership at the Opera House said, we've got to get some air conditioning in here in order to be viable as an event place for 12 months of the year. So we now play in an air-conditioned environment. That's not very Baroque, I must admit. But we also don't have quite the climate of Bach, I suppose, but who knows, back in 1600s.
Well, it keeps the at least it keeps the harpsichord in tune. That's the key,
right? Yeah, there are jokes about that. You know, I won't say the harpsichord, but they say the lute is an instrument that's 50% of the time you spend tuning it, and the other 50% of the time you spend playing out of tune. So, with apologies to lutenists out there, and I certainly wouldn't want to imply it happened with the harpsichord as well. But
well, I can vouch for the lute in a sense, because I spent a summer at a Shakespeare festival as a character who had to play the lute, and keeping that darn thing in tune was difficult.
Too many strings. It has too many strings.
Too many strings. So you're coming. Obviously, you're coming back, and we have a weekend long festival. We're going Friday, June 10th, Saturday, June 11th, and Sunday, June 12th. And I want to talk a little bit about the program, some of the things that you've chosen. I'm particularly taken on the Friday night from the Byron Adams. I believe that's Monteverdiana. That's a world premiere. Tell us a little bit about that one.
Yeah, but there's an example of how did Bach's music affect later generations. And there's a whole myriad of connections between Byron Adams' music and myself. And the last piece on that program by Vaughan Williams, the oboe concerto, mm-hmm. because I have a very good friend whose name is Byron Adams, the very one who's the composer here, who also is a bit of an expert on Ralph Vaughan Williams and his world. And I was consulting with him during the pandemic when all of us got a chance to think a lot and not perform much at all. But thinking about various aspects of, did Bach know that he was a Baroque composer? Did Bach know that he was writing Baroque music? Did Mozart know that he was writing classical music, Beethoven, romantic music? I would say no. They were just writing the music of their time. Mm-hmm. And in fact, Baroque music didn't really have that label until well into the 20th century, if you can believe that.
Wow.
So you wouldn't find, even though we know that Beethoven, for example, studied the music of Handel and adored it and loved it, he wasn't kind of in this category of having gone to music school, and we learned that the Baroque period is 1600 to 1750. And I do this little thought experiment within my program intro this year by saying, let's just imagine at New Year's Eve on 1750, Bach has died. We all know that's the end of the Baroque period. Did everybody in Europe get together in this big bonfire room and burn all of their Baroque bows? Absolutely not.
No.
This was a very, very smooth transition over generations. And in fact, it's still occurring. So to go back to your original point, it was interesting to hear Byron talk about the fact that Vaughan Williams didn't like Baroque music and refused to even acknowledge that Bach was a Baroque composer because he did like Bach's music. Who can deny that?
Right.
So I thought it would be very interesting then to take a festival and concentrate a little bit on, so what did composers who hated Baroque music think music should be?
There's a unique point of view.
well, it's because we're lucky because we can step back and we can see the unfolding of music history, and then of course we all put labels on things, don't we? So Baroque, Renaissance, or classical, and Romantic, and 20th century. What do we do now? It's 21st century. Contemporary music. Mm-hmm. It was all contemporary music,
right?
At one point.
I'm sure 100 years from now they'll have a title for our contemporary music. They'll call it something.
If we're lucky.
If we're lucky.
We're going to go under the trash pit of history. The trash pile of history. So I just think that the Baroque music has had such a profound effect on music generally, and especially concert music that we, classical music that we know and study and revere. And finding the right mix has been the 25-year odyssey for us, a mix between our modern sensibility and our modern understanding of what instruments are capable of, and performing music of Bach's time, and putting ourselves in the position, if we didn't know any music after Bach, if we didn't know Mozart's music or Beethoven's music or Brahms's music, we'd put ourselves in the position of being like Bach, who didn't know those composers either.
Right.
All he knew was his own music and music of his contemporaries. Mm-hmm. And he learned dramatically from Corelli, Vivaldi, for sure. But how would we perform his music if we were faced with the same reality of we don't know what music is being written tomorrow? And in fact, we don't care. We care about the music that's written today.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it seems like you have an interesting perspective in what you've chosen for the festival, because there's actually, as I looked at the program, really only one composition by Bach himself, as I can see. You have two by his son, and then you have some Vivaldi, some Mozart, and some Corelli, and some Bach as well. But just the one by Bach, was that deliberate?
There's a very, very interesting fact. Our listeners may know that Bach's music is designated by BWV, Bach markings, numbers. Uh-huh. BWV 1056 is the F minor harpsichord concerto that we're about to play. Mm-hmm. These numbers were assigned by scholars according to the genre. So all of the Bach Brandenburg concertos, there are six of them, occupy six consecutive numbers. All of the 10 or so harpsichord pieces invoke 10 consecutive numbers. So we can't tell, like, Mozart Requiem is Kerschel 626. Mm-hmm. That Kerschel number, 626, is a big number. We can reliably say it means it was a late piece.
Right.
Kerschel 19 was written when Mozart was probably 9 or something. We can tell from the number when a piece was in the output of a given composer, Mozart in particular. Beethoven's opus number is the same. BWV numbers are not like that. What we can tell, though, is that if we're doing 1056 and we know it's a harpsichord concerto, chances are 1057 is a harpsichord concerto as well. Mm-hmm. But there's no real logic to it. We all the cantatas, for example, were listed first. So BWV 1 is Bach's earliest cantata that we know of, and that goes into the hundreds. So here's the dirty little secret: there are only something like 19 numbers of Bach's pieces that are for orchestra, what we call orchestra. So here we are in our 25th year. We've had this little core of 19 pieces that we can do that are all Bach, and we have done them. And we have looked at them from various angles. They've gone beyond. We've done all sorts of things. But nothing's going to change. There's still only 19 pieces. And six of them are the Brandenburgs.
Right. Okay. So okay. I see where you're going.
19 types of pieces.
Right.
19 pieces. So there is actually a really small amount of literature. And we started to branch out before the pandemic hit. And our last program that we performed was Handel's Messiah with 4 solo singers singing both the chorus parts and the solo parts. Mm-hmm. And it was remarkably effective. And what I had planned for the real 25th, in other words, in year 25, and now we're in year 27 because we took 2 years off because of the pandemic,
right.
I was going to try to contrast a Handel, not oratorio of Messiah, but a Handel opera, Julius Caesar, and a big Bach passion with singers and telling the story of the life and death of Christ. Mm. Well, it just turns out you need a lot of people to do, even if you only do it one on a part. And a lot of concern about the spreading of the virus, especially among singers, led us to realize that we have to once again politely close the door on those hundreds of works that are the core of Bach's music, which are vocal.
Mm-hmm.
So we actually set ourselves probably a much harder task than I would have imagined. I wouldn't have imagined we were doing 25 years of this either, you know.
Right.
Back in 1996, who would have known? But
exactly,
I couldn't have imagined back then that we would, in a sense, run out of repertoire. But the great thing is that we haven't run out of finding new perspectives on that repertoire, new meanings in that music, and that means we do a world premiere based on the idea that hey, this Baroque period had some pretty fruitful ideas thrown around in it. And a Monteverdiana, Byron Adams has taken some thematic material written by Monteverdi, who was the most famous Baroque composers of opera, and worked them in his own way into a 4-movement work, which he's called Monteverdiana.
Mm-hmm.
And so now we're going to be able to see what a scholar of Vaughan Williams, whom is on record as not liking Baroque music, in fact, Barroco is a Portuguese term, I'm told, that means misshapen pearl.
Ah.
And like a misshapen pearl, it has no value.
Uh-huh.
It was a term that was derogatory for the longest time.
Well, it's certainly you've put a lot of thought into the program because it's quite interesting. And I mean, even the orchestrations, a bassoon concerto, a piano concerto, a cello concerto. So you've managed to keep the orchestration pretty tight as well.
Yeah, well, that's one of the both challenges and opportunities of the festival. I think that while it becomes difficult to program because we have only a few players available, we also then know that our musical performance is going to have an enhanced transparency, if I could come up with that term, because of the fewer number of players. And we've done music of Ravel on the festival, the Tombeau de Couperin, obviously a nod to the Baroque, and that's where you see the Beyond connection. But boy, that's one of the performances that still lives on in my memory as so beautifully transparent compared with what you often hear with a larger group. playing it. And I think that in the context of what is the opera house's space, the opera house is not King Concert Hall.
No, not at all.
And that was the hall that I did all of my performing while I was on the faculty at Fredonia, was in that hall. There is now a recital hall, of course, which I've never actually performed in. But the opera house is a unique venue. It's very clear. And occasionally has the accompaniment of motorcycles as they roar by outside, as our digital tapes reveal quite beautifully.
I think they have done a little bit in the restoration to soften that blow slightly. So, you know, I mean, that's...
Unfortunately, the motorcycle manufacturers have been doing their bit too.
Now, you also give a series of pre-concert conversations, lectures, and stuff like that. Because one of the things that I'm so clear about in my memory about the way you approach classical music is you have an ability to keep it light and fun, and you've always been able to do that. Do you have anything particular planned for these conversations, or do you just take questions and answers from the audience? How are you going to go about that?
Well, we could take questions and answers. We don't typically, even though it may come to that if at some point I don't have something to say about music. But I was just the other week speaking to a graduate conducting student saying, you know, I do a lot of pre-concert talks, and I can honestly say to you that I rarely prepare anything. I used to tell jokes at concerts.
Yes, exactly. That's what I remember.
And I don't tell jokes anymore. I try to keep it light and fun.
Yes.
But I've realized that, in fact, the way I communicate with other human beings is most genuine when I just simply am off the cuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so I walk out on stage to speak before a piece, and I actually have no idea what I'm going to start with. Mm. And I have about 10 seconds from the time that I get from behind the curtain to the first word I have to utter to figure out how am I going to start on this. But at the basis of it all for me is, can I talk about this music that helps an audience member understand why I think it's so wonderful, why I think it's worth my time and your time to spend together and listen to it. And if I just talk about the music from that point of view, I have a little bit of a fudge against getting too technical.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, I think one of the things that I've discovered over time is I'm pretty good at reading an audience's reaction. Like, are they getting this? Are they digging it? Or is this just way, way too esoteric for them? Am I getting into the weeds way too much? But they can hold a lot of information at once, you know, and just a simple thing like dates, bearing in mind that if we know dates, it's a lot easier to remember new ones. And if you don't know any dates at all, especially of the history of music, it's hard to hold it all together. But once you do know some dates, you start to get a perspective on the reality of how music was made. And I'll just give you a quick example. If we know, for example, that Bach died in 1750, mm-hmm. It's helpful to know that Haydn was born in 1732. In other words, Haydn was 18 years old when Bach died, when this sudden end of the Baroque era apparently occurred. But 1791, when Mozart died, Haydn was still alive.
Mm.
Bach had been dead for 41 years, but it's possible to imagine that Haydn's 104th symphony, for example, was written in 1795, to give you an example, that Haydn being born in 1732, he could have had a player in his orchestra who played Haydn's 104th symphony at age 65.
Mm-hmm.
And what an amazing thought that is to talk about from the point of view of a human being to another human being. So I'm talking about now, to answer your question about talking to the audience about the music, if we can just put it in human terms and I think, yeah, I could be that 18-year-old boy. And when I'm 65, I'm saying, yeah, I played for Bach.
Right.
Yeah, on one of his New Year's Eve services at St. Thomas Kirche. I was there. I played my violin. It's the same violin as I have now. And I said, aha, so Baroque bow is still being used to play Haydn's 104th symphony.
Right. Right.
So you make those kind of connections and you kind of prove your case a little bit that it's just a human endeavor. And the good thing is to have some taste and then apply it.
Yes.
And the same with food, isn't it?
Exactly.
Eat what you like.
Yes, eat what you like. It's wonderful. Well, I know everybody at the Opera House is looking forward to having you come. We look forward to this festival every year in Fredonia. And I know the 2 years we didn't have it at the pandemic was a very empty feeling. So, it's going to be great to welcome you back. And I think that, you know, when I look at the program, I say, well, it's really quite well chosen for the times and the situation that we have. So people are going to get their money's worth for sure, I think.
I think with a very big bang, we can say that this has the piece of Bach, the harpsichord concerto, a piece that he would be well identified with during his own lifetime, and looks over centuries and comes back to the idea of why are we still playing this music? Because composers today are still being inspired, not only by Bach's music, by the people who inspired Bach, Corelli, Vivaldi, and then Bach's own sons, J.C. Bach, as a prime example, a couple of pieces by him. Really, if we wish to, we can stand back and just enjoy the beautiful music, or we can try to put it in a context of, wow, the wheels are turning, the cogs are spinning, interlocking at all times. One day leads to the next. There's no such thing as, oh, now it's the Rococo period. Oh, now it's the classical period. No, it's convenient to teach music history that way, yes. But it's not how human beings develop.
Exactly. Exactly. Grant, listen, thank you for your time very much today. I very much appreciate you coming on the program, and I hope you and I can do this annually now with this podcast for, you know, as long as we both got it going.
Good deal. We'll see you then.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Grant. We'll look forward to seeing you when you come.
Thank you.
It's going to be a real treat having the Bach and Beyond Festival up and running again this year. Bach and Beyond will be performing on June 10th, 11th, and 12th. The Friday and Saturday night concerts begin at 8 p.m., while the concluding Sunday afternoon concert begins at 3 p.m. Tickets are available by calling the 1891 Fredonia Box office at 716-679-1891. A three-day subscription is only $51, a savings of $9 over the price of each event individually. And that's it for this summer startup edition of Notes from the Aisle Seat. My thanks to Maestro Grant Cooper and Ms. Marcia Merrins for being my guests on this episode. Notes from the Aisle Seat is a production of the 1891 Fredonia Opera House in Fredonia, New York. For more information on any of the Opera House's events, call the box office at 716-679-1891, visit the website at www.fredopera.org, or email at operahouse@fredopera.org. Notes from the Aisle Seat is now available wherever you get your podcasts, including Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Amazon Music, and also on the Opera House YouTube channel. If you like this podcast, please consider following us by clicking the follow button on our website, aisleseat.podbean.com, and spreading the word through your social media feeds. If you have an arts event you'd like featured on the podcast, why don't you drop us a line at operahouse@fredopera.org, and we'll see about featuring your event. Please try to give us a month's advance notice if possible to facilitate timely scheduling. We'll return in 2 weeks on June 8th, 2022. I'm Tom Laughlin, and until then, be safe out there and be kind to one another.